I think the question of, as Lenin put it, the question of having a revolutionary party was the question of the working class having the ability to self-emancipate itself, but at the same time, the question of what layer inside the working class would be able to change things. And Lenin put forward two key central ideas, which I think is valuable for us today. When we look at Trump, when we look at the crisis of imperialist wars, when we look at how to change and challenge that, the question of what revolutionaries do is absolutely essential. The shape of where we live is changed, not necessarily, it's changed by how the masses do it, but how the leadership of the masses do it. For me, I'm confronted all the time by the question of why Marine Le Pen has an organisation of 50,000, and why in this country, the original name of the National Front came from this country. The National Front in France was a section of the National Front in this country in the 1970s. That's where it came from. So how comes the National Front in France is on the verge of winning the first possibility under Marine Le Pen as the president, and in this country they've been trounced? And I would argue that the smallest mass revolutionary party in the world has played a crucial part in terms of shaping history. History is not just made by the people at the top of society, it's made by what people do as individuals. And that's the most important thing for us today, because all the time, one of the most powerful weapons that the ruling class has is to tell working class people that they cannot change or shape anything to do with their own lives. And that's partly true. We are oppressed by the ruling ideas in society. But the difference between Lenin and Marx was that Marx analysed how the dynamic of that took place. What Lenin put together was a question of an organised layer of people that could intellectually, politically and practically talk about how they intervened in it. And they used different tools at different times in order to change this. I haven't got a lot of time, so I only want to talk about two things very quickly. I want to talk about the nature of the United Front, and I want to talk about the nature of being a revolutionary today. Because when you read Lenin, Lenin says something very important. He says this. He says that a revolutionary is not a trade union secretary. He says a revolutionary is a tribune of the oppressed. And it's important that we understand that, because often when people talk about revolutionary politics, they say, absolutely, we believe the working class is at the center of change. The transformation of being able to have power matters. I remember on a demonstration when the EDL was marching in East London, the EDL never arrived at our demonstration. You know why they didn't arrive? Because the RMT shut down the trains. So they were left on the trains. And that decision was taken by quite a branch, maybe 15 or 20 people, said we're switching the station. In fact, they went to the trainmaster inside Liverpool Street station, one of the biggest stations in this country, and said we're shutting it down because we can't guarantee the safety of our Muslim brothers and sisters if you let those people in. See, that's tremendous class power, and it's often ignored. We'd like to see more of it. But actually, some of the people that fight, this is what Lenin said. He said, working class consciousness cannot be reduced just to trade union conference. He said, political consciousness, unless the workers are trained to respond to all cases of tyranny, oppression, violence, abuse, no matter from what class it comes from or affected. That's quite important. It means that sometimes you are confronted by, you go to a mosque. And when you go to a mosque, yes, the majority of people going to the mosque are working class, but not all the people who are running it are, particularly what you describe coming from the working class. The question is, actually, they're described as classical petty bourgeois. But they are oppressed if they can't go to their mosque and pray without somebody standing out and oppressing them. A woman will be oppressed if they tear off her hijab. So the question of how we apply Leninism today is often complicated. You see, we defend the traditions of the Enlightenment. But when you look at the question of what's happened inside France, actually, there's a high level of political consciousness and philosophical discussion amongst the French left. But when it comes to the question of getting this question right, you have to go back to Lenin. You see, you defend the Enlightenment project, but do you defend it to the point of where you don't defend the right of a woman to wear what she wants? Then those two things are in contradiction, aren't they? The Enlightenment project and religion are in contradiction. How do you overcome these contradictions? You have to go back to the Lenin tradition of the standing for the tribune of the oppressed. And it matters, because if the whole of the movement had gathered against the small National Front in 1981, then actually Marine Le Pen would not be what she is today, because they'd have been smashed much earlier. But what happened was they refused to allow black, Muslim, the working class and the left refused to come together because they couldn't accept the question of the right of a schoolgirl's what to wear inside schools. Politics matters, and the clarity of revolutionary organisation makes a difference. And that's the reason why, when we talk about tribune of the oppressed, we're against all forms of oppression, but we have to lead that struggle. We have to shape it. And I think that's what we've been central. We've been central to been doing to do. And the question of the United Front and the Tribune United Front is critical. It's how you work with other people, but not reducing yourself, to them. So, if you look at something like Unite Against Fascism, or Stand Up to Racism, it will have, it, you know, you'll work with the leader of the Labour Party. You'll work with Jeremy Corbyn. Because why? Because actually, when you look at the Jeremy Corbyn, or the TUC will call a joint demonstration with us on the 18th of March, that's very important that we joined with those people. We said, let's bring the mass of the working class into a struggle that demanded a fight against racism. Not only that, there's a question of internationalism. It matters that our comrades in other countries say there's a central fight for refugees and we have to put this together. We have to put this together. So small, tiny organisations of less than 50 people have called demonstrations inside Poland, inside other countries on the 18th of March. Why? Because we're internationalist. We don't start from just being inside this country. I know I can't talk about Owen Jones, but you know the biggest argument I had with Owen Jones? I'll tell you what the biggest argument was not about what happened inside. You know what it was? It was about patriotism. Can you be a left patriot? And he said to me, I trace my background all the way back to the Iron Age. I said, I trace my background all the way back to humanity in Africa. Do you know what I mean? Because for us, we don't start from there. We don't start from the boundaries. We start from the fact of why we've got something collectively together, and we don't accept that we stand behind the Union Jack as the major point. We don't want to outflank the question of the Union Jack, because actually that breaks the unity of our class. And we have to understand how to do that without coming across. We have to, I mean, today on the front page of the paper, where it says that EU workers, people from who've been here for 20 years who have no rights, we start from saying that's disgusting and that we reject it. But more than that, we start off by fighting to make sure that's different. So you work with people, and then you have to sometimes, you have to work against them. So you stand in a meet, you're working with people, and then they say that what we want to do is we want to say that anybody that voted Brexit is a racist. And they'll put it in there. So you have to work with people that are who want to say that the most important thing is what happens to British capital. See, you have to turn around and actually say British capitalism isn't that great. Let's look at its track record. Slavery, imperialism, war. Do you mean, why should we celebrate these things, right? Then they look uncomfortable. And then everybody's uncomfortable in the room. You have to have those uncomfortable moments with people. Say why we won't do it, yeah? If you don't do that, actually, you make compromises with people, you make the wrong kind of compromise with people. You have to fight in order to make sure socialist politics and things that will take the working class are forward. Not in a kind of way you repeat what Lenin says, but where you make it happen. It matters that there is a demonstration with all those forces. We haven't capitulated to that, but we're at the centre of that, and it matters that you can shape that, not just here, but as part of the international tradition. Part of that means the question of building a revolutionary party. You see, critically, for me, it matters as well, the amount of numbers that are there. Because Trotsky, when he developed the theory of the United Front, he was right about the question of what Hitler represented. But Trotsky only had 50 members. And it doesn't matter if you're a genius and you've only got 50 members. Quality and quantity matters. It's an old dialectical thing. The amount of quantity of people you have will affect the quality of the impact that you have. And it means that you can turn your ideas into material force if you have an organised party to do it. So when we talk about Leninism today, and when people talk to us about Leninism, they think we're talking about Lenin's tomb. They think they're talking about history. What we're talking about is bringing alive the history of the Russian Revolution today. Because the best thing was, the Tsar wrote inside his diary, I don't know what's happening. Right? I don't know what's happening, right? And that's what we want Theresa May to write. Right? Well, I don't know what's happening, right? Who are these people coming to it? But what the real truth is, but all the way through, all the way from the formation of the Bolshevik Party to its ability to lead the Russian Revolution, the smallest mass revolutionary party in the world, it played a part on a day-to-day basis until it could play the role of shaping the working class in order to challenge and change things. And that's what we're doing. We're practicing every day for the question of the insurrection, so that every comrade is able to do that, but also in order to increase the size of the party and being able to shape it. And I'll stop there and leave it over to
But now I'm going to bring in Charlie Kimber, who's going to be our last speaker today, who's the Joint National Secretary of the SWP and editor of Socialist Worker.
Thanks, Sarah. Thanks for everyone who's taken part today. In Socialist Worker, our newspaper, we're trying each week to write a column about some aspect of the Russian Revolution and sort of try and make the arguments relevant to today. And that will be eventually 51 columns. So there's quite a lot to write about. So I'm going to try and give a very shortened version of why I think the Russian Revolution is still relevant today. The politics of Lenin are still relevant today and need to guide the practice of revolutionaries at the moment. The first question, the biggest question, is to understand that capitalism is a system that produces war, racism, and poverty. That was true in Lenin's day. It was in the midst of the First World War, the period in which the brutality of capitalism had been laid bare most clearly. You know, it's often said that revolution is a violent process. It was as nothing compared to what the First World War saw, the mass manufacture of death caused by capitalist rivalries. The besuited gentlemen of the ruling classes of Europe had caused the most horrendous slaughter ever seen in human history. And today, capitalism is just as prone to war, just as prone to causing racism and division, and even more concentrated in terms of its inequality. You will have seen the statistic quite recently that 8 men now have as much wealth as the bottom half of the world's population, 3.5 billion people. There was a big row about this in the boss's magazine, The Economist, which said it's not really true. Not really true. If you look at the treatment of currency exchange, and if you look at the question of debt, it doesn't really treat this properly, this Oxfam survey. The truth is it's 98 billionaires, not 8. As if, oh, that's all right then. That's fine. Oh, it's only 100 people, 2 coach loads, rather than 1 people carrier. Oh, that's fine. What a wonderful system we live under. And of course, to add to the crimes of capitalism that Lenin would have known of, the question of environmental catastrophe as well. That capitalism not simply produces wars, which would be nuclear wars potentially today, but also is driving the whole of humanity over the edge of a cliff. That system's so crazy that even though it would destroy every possibility of life, still the mechanism of profit pushes this towards happening. That's, I think, an absolutely basic understanding that the system we faced then, at the beginning of the 20th century, is the same system. Doesn't look quite the same in every aspect, but still crucially the same at the beginning of the 21st century. The second understanding that Lenin and the Bolsheviks had was that power doesn't lie in parliament. That, of course, I mean, Lenin wrote extensively about why elections matter, about why parliaments matter, and so on. That's taken for granted. But in the end, power doesn't lie in parliament. That the critical decisions are not open to democratic vote, but are taken by unaccountable elites who do not offer any of their real power open to what goes on in terms of a parliamentary vote. That was what obvious in Russia in 1917. Got rid of the Tsar, you create a parliamentary system, everybody wants to end the war, but the war doesn't end. The war continues. The generals and the big business and the people who run the state machinery, they continue with the war. Even in the June of 1917, pouring a huge offensive in which 40,000 people died. This understanding of where power lies is still absolutely basic when we look at capitalism today. It's very, very important because the alternative is you end up with the sorts of problems that Syriza in Greece faced, that you can win an election, but it changes nothing in terms of the determination of the bosses and the bankers and the EU institutions to implement austerity. And by placing your hopes on not the struggle in the streets and the workplaces and the organisations that can lead to, but on the parliamentary sphere, that leads to the tragedy of what's happened in Greece, of Syriza ending up tear-gassing pensioners who protests over the cuts, of herding refugees into detention centres and threatening to send them to the tender mercies of the Erdogan regime in Turkey, of implementing a worse austerity program than that of its conservative predecessors. And this is our argument about Corbyn. Corbyn's victory inside the Labour Party twice is of the greatest importance. It's a hugely inspiring feel that hundreds of thousands of people like the message of being against racism, austerity, and of wanting to be a socialist. But the truth is that Corbyn would face that same problem as faced Syriza in Greece or François Hollande in France, and therefore the necessity for us to root our struggles in the streets and the workplaces and not in the parliamentary sphere. The third thing is the working class as the force for change. And here, you look at Russia, what was the working class? We can argue about it. 5 million, 10 million people out of 160 million people. Yet they played the absolutely crucial role. Not that they were the only people that Lenin and the Bolsheviks worried about. Of course not. There were 120 million peasants, and the crucial thing was for the working class to give a leadership to the peasantry and enable it to bring down the Tsar and then begin to create a society which acted in the interests of the immense majority. And this understanding of the working class being the force, which is still the one which is able to collectively change society around it, is still absolutely basic, I think, in the modern world. Why was there such a furore just before Christmas about the Southern Rail strikes? You know, there are very few strikes in Britain today. Let's be honest about this. Very, very few compared, you know, even to the 1970s or the 1980s. But the trouble is that all the newspaper columnists and the Tory MPs had learnt this extraordinary lesson that if people don't turn up to drive the trains and to be guards on the trains don't run. All the brilliance of the entrepreneurs and the bosses, the trains do not run. And that this is a major problem in society because you have to get people to come and work in other places. And this is the power that workers have. I mean, one of the really exciting things in America at the moment is that people, in smallish numbers, but are beginning to talk about strikes against what Trump is trying to do over migrants, of trying to deport people and to the Muslim ban and so on. Very, very exciting because it looks back to a period of the 1st of May in 2006 when there was a massive strike against an anti-migration set of laws, and they were defeated. They were defeated in America. You know, very nasty government, and nonetheless, they were defeated. And this is the hope today, that if you had the power of workers allied with the immense energy and those incredibly inspiring women's marches and the marches that have taken place and subsequently to this, this is our power. And we should expect it to come about in unusual ways. If we were having this meeting in the 1880s, which I regard as unlikely, but still, it certainly wouldn't have been like remembering the Russian Revolution because that hadn't happened. But anyway, if we were having this meeting in the 1880s, none of us would have predicted that the key group of workers who were going to transform the situation in Britain were a group of women working in East London, known as the Match Women. The vast majority of them, teenagers, and the vast majority of them, migrants from Ireland. Nonetheless, their struggle was absolutely transformative for the British working class. I don't know what struggle will be transformative for the British working class today, and it won't just be one class, and it won't be just one struggle. But nonetheless, we know that the potential of the working class remains stronger in a world where now the working class and its dependents are the majority of society in a way that was completely different to that which existed in 1917. But of course, although the working class is central, it must also act, as Weyman quite rightly said, as the liberator of the oppressed. That the 1917, one of the most exciting things about it, is that example of women's rights, of LGBT rights, of national rights, of the rights of Muslims, of the way in which Jews were suddenly able to become people at the top of society rather than facing the pogrom and the oppression inside that society. This is one of the extraordinary achievements of a very, very backward society in which rights were won, which people are still fighting for in most of the world today. This is the great hope, and it's one that we have to place ourselves so strongly in being the people who stand against racism, who stand against all forms of division and oppression. And this is also linked to the question of internationalism. You see, internationalism is certainly about recognizing that our sisters and brothers are in China or in Latin America or in Africa rather than the people at the top of society in Britain. That's very, very important to understand. It's very important to understand that socialism in one country is impossible and that it needs to be an international revolutionary project in order to achieve change, even more so
today. Those are very important. But if you really want to think about what internationalism means at the moment, take up the question of migration, of open borders, of fighting against Islamophobia and the attacks on refugees. This is what it means to be an internationalist in 2017. And there was a quote from Leon Trotsky, one of the leaders of the Russian Revolution, which I read 40 years ago, and it still sends a shiver down my spine because it's still so relevant. And it tells you what capitalism will always be like, that capitalism will always produce racism, will always produce anti-migrant feeling. I want to share it with you. Trotsky wrote this in 1940, after just before he was murdered by Stalin's agent. The world of decaying capitalism is overcrowded. The question of admitting 100 extra refugees becomes a major problem for such a world power as the United States. In an era of aviation, telegraph, telephone, radio and television, travel from country to country is paralyzed by passports and visas. Today, decaying capitalist society is striving to squeeze the Jewish people from all its pores. 17 million individuals out of the 2 million populating the globe can no longer find a place on our planet. Amid the vast expanses of land and the marvels of technology, which have conquered the skies as well as the earth, the bourgeoisie has managed to convert our planet into a foul prison. Change one or two words, and that is exactly the same as the situation we face today. And being an internationalist and being a Leninist is about standing on the side of the migrants, of the refugees, of building Stand Up to Racism, of building the demonstrations on the 18th of March. But it's also saying that for as long as we have capitalist society, we will have the attempts by those at the top of that society to turn it into a foul prison. And only destroying capitalism can make sure that is defeated. Socialism is about workers' power, workers' democracy, or it is nothing. That's what we learned from the Russian Revolution. With the extinction of the push towards international revolution and the sense of workers' power and workers' control, it was impossible for that revolution to survive, and it became a caricature, the opposite of socialism, rather than socialism itself. If we're going to achieve this, what's the crucial thing that we have to learn? All of what I've spoken about is important, but the question of organization matters. Weyman spoke about why are we different to France? Why are we different to the situation in Hungary? We're different because of the political actions that people have taken. Nothing happens automatically. Nothing happens automatically. It depends on politics and organization. And the creation of revolutionary party is more important than it ever has been. That there will be key decisions to be taken about what sort of united fronts are formed, whether we confine our struggles essentially to those of a parliamentary nature or root them more broadly and deeply than that. And what are we fighting for? Are we fighting just to change capitalism in some small ways, to tinker at the edges of capitalism, or are we trying to tear down the whole edifice of capitalism? And that requires revolutionary organization, because as 1917 showed, you could overthrow the Tsar with essentially, not entirely, but essentially spontaneous movements from below. Trained in the Bolshevik tradition in many, many ways, but nonetheless, immense spontaneous movements. It was not possible to achieve October spontaneously. It took organization, it took arguments, it took leadership inside the working class so that people in the key factories, in the key workplaces, were able to show the people around them about how they could conquer power, end the war, and achieve a society pushing towards greater peace and equality. That's still true today. There will be key moments in which the decisions have to be taken. And Russia is the positive example that shows the role a revolutionary organization can play. We have had far too many negative examples since. The German Revolution that followed so swiftly on the heels of the Russian Revolution, led by brilliant people, Rosa Luxemburg, Karl Liebknecht, great, courageous people, great thinkers, people who were giants of the revolutionary tradition. Nonetheless, it was defeated because Luxemburg and Liebknecht had never created, except right at the end, an attempt to have a revolutionary organization. Right up to the great achievements of toppling Mubarak in Egypt in 2011, but too soon hurled back by the counter-revolution of el-Sisi and the ruling class in Egypt. Why? Because there wasn't a strong enough organization built in advance of the revolutionary movement of 2011 which could provide a way for workers to deepen their struggle, to create the methods of the Soviet and the Workers' Council and so on to contest, not just for the removal of some of the worst aspects of the old regime, but to create a different society based on workers' power. They could remove their Tsar in Egypt in 2011, but they couldn't have their October. And we have to make sure that in every opportunity where it's possible, that requires the building of revolutionary organization. Now, we are not in a situation yet like February 1917 in Russia. We're not. But nonetheless, the building of the revolutionary organization is important in terms of creating the biggest possible resistance to the Tories, to the system they create, to Trump and the whole panoply of ruling class power, but also to build for something afterwards, to build for something bigger than that, to put forward a vision of socialism. You can't, in the end, inspire people by the idea that we will one day have a society, perhaps if we struggle forever, where we have a £10 minimum wage. I'm for a £10 an hour minimum wage, right? But I'm for rather more than that as well. I'm for tearing out the roots of racism and homophobia and women's oppression. I'm for a society where genuinely people come before profit. I'm for a society where genuinely we are capable of directing our own futures together and democratically. And that requires a revolutionary transformation, and that requires a revolutionary organization built as part of the working class, but also able to give leadership to the working class. Normally, I'd say at this stage, that's why you should join the Socialist Workers' Party. I imagine most of you are members of the Socialist Workers' Party. If any of you aren't, please do join the Socialist Workers' Party. But there's something more than that as well. Most of you are young or youngish people. I always say that because the students who led the Soweto revolt in 1976 in South Africa, most of them 15 or 16-year-olds, which we should always remember when people say that young people can't change things. But nonetheless, there's a question. Are you going to build this thing? Are you going to get involved in it? Are you going to expend energy and effort and money on it? And that's a big question. It's a very, very big question for all of us, in truth. Franz Fanon, you may have heard of, Franz Fanon was a brilliant anti-colonialist, wrote some great stuff, well worth looking at the writings of Fanon. Fanon put it like this, and I think it's an extreme formulation, right? So don't hold me to it. But Fanon wrote this: we are nothing on earth if we are not, first of all, slaves of a cause. The cause of the people, the cause of justice, the cause of liberty. Now, slaves of a cause is a rather extreme example. I'm not asking you to be a slave. Fanon may have thought he could get away with it, but nonetheless, I'm not doing that, all right? But there is a point, and the point is people need to be leaders. Not slaves, but leaders. They need to be leaders of those around them, because by leadership, we don't talk about people sitting on a top table delivering imposing proclamations to everyone else around them, which they follow without thought. Not at all. Our argument in the SWP is asking people to take themselves seriously, to read, to learn, to think, to argue, to discuss, to say when you disagree, to cause trouble, but to be part of a revolutionary organisation. That's what it means, to devote energy and effort, and it's worth it. Because if we are to transform the world, it requires the building of that organisation, and in the end, that comes down to the decisions of hundreds and thousands and tens of thousands of people. So I don't ask you to be a slave, as Fanon did, but I do ask you to be a leader inside this movement, to be part of it, to build it, to win other people to it, to fight for the possibility of revolutionary transformation that was seen in 1917, and which in a sick world, which will produce war, poverty, racism, and environmental catastrophe, requires socialist revolution, and you have to be part of it.